my psychology, we'd say, huh. And they'd say, well, where'd you get it? And we'd say, well, there are these other traditions where people have been studying how do you manage on the planet as a human being, and the stuff that's worked sifts out. So you have to look at if something's been working for 1,000 years, probably it's pretty good, or at least it's worth checking. And so we were instantly incredibly naive and very, very sophisticated. There's a lot of, oh, the Eastern people have done this for so long and they are so smart and they, therefore, we should study under them. One of the things we learn, being psychologists, is we know a lot about childhood. And most Eastern traditions have no interest in it. And if you ask a guru, just an Indian guru, what was your childhood like? I'll tell you, any guru would give me, I'll give you the same answer. Oh, it was very good. It was fine. And you should honor your mother and your father. Anything happened in childhood? No. Come on, what happened in childhood? Now we will breed together, and we will approach bliss together. And what's your problem, buddy? What is this bring up of childhood that I have not thought about in decades? So we have actually a very sophisticated observation of the effects of childhood on adulthood, maybe excessive. They have an incredibly sophisticated view of what do you do when you're really trying to train your mind. So we see transpersonal psychology not as a meeting of East and West, not as a blending of East and West, but as a constant interaction of what's working in each of these multiple systems, so that for most of our work is in the West, and so the blend is seen more as it's useful for Westerners. But the Japanese Transpersonal Association runs the blend a little differently and is a enormously popular and powerful growing influence in Japanese psychotherapy and psychology and education. My own involvement in psychedelics predates most of the culture's involvement, because as an undergraduate at Harvard, I had worked with a very bright, very charming, very neurotic young professor named Richard Alpert. And Richard Alpert brought me out to Stanford on a summer research project along with a very, very bright graduate student named Ralph Metzner. And so we did research. And I didn't know anything, and so I was the kind of gopher of the group and knew the least, but I was a bright kid. And so we became friends. And actually, on my way back to Harvard, I had a car accident, and Dick Alpert really was incredibly helpful in making sure I could do my senior year, and so forth and so on. So we were genuinely the way it is with a good professor and a good student, that kind of mentor relationship. And then I finished, went off, and was living in France. And he came over to do a speech with Aldous Huxley and Tim Leary at an international psychological something or other in Copenhagen. And it was the first time they were going to talk about psychedelics, which had happened in the year I was away. So Dick Alpert met me in Paris, you know, his ex-student, and he said, the most wonderful thing in the world has happened to me, and I want to share it with you. And I looked at this man, who I knew fairly well, and one of the things that you get from a Harvard education is an unbelievably undeserved arrogance about everything. And so I looked at him with my usual arrogance and saw that instead of the highly neurotic, bright, interesting man I knew was a much healthier guy. Just energetically, and I didn't use the term then because I didn't know what it meant, he felt better, he sounded better, he seemed better, he was easier to be with, and I thought, hey man, I don't know what you're talking about, but it sure looks good. And then he reached into his pocket and came out with this little vial of something, and I thought, what is he talking about? I mean, I didn't drink coffee. And if I had a beer, it was only to prove that I was overage. And here he was offering me a pill, and I thought, I don't know about this, but the evidence is good. So we sat in a cafe, and he gave me a couple of pills of psilocybin, what we would now call a moderately low dose, and we're sitting there, and the colors are getting brighter, and the noise is getting crisper, and I'm hearing things, you know, I'm hearing more stuff, more sensory input, and it's getting very intense. And I say to him, now this is his first trip to Paris, and I say to him, this is really just too much for me. He says, it's too much for me, and I'm not taking anything. I'm just a tourist. And so we went back to my little walk-up hotel room, and for the next few hours, I found that as I relaxed into this experience, that a lot of my theories of what was necessary for me to be who I was were limited. And that a level of human interaction and closeness, kind of vibing good buddies, emerged at a level that was inconceivable to me 5 hours earlier. And I also went through a great personal revelation, which is, if you took away my books, I would not die. Because when you come out of a Harvard education, it's fairly clear that you probably would die without your books. And a week later, he was off to Copenhagen. And a couple of days after that, I followed him and said, I don't know what we did, but I didn't quite get all of it. And so we did it again. And in those days, the model with psilocybin is both people would take it at the same time. So we had another experience, which was, again, very moving for me, and I went off and continued to live my life, and eventually ended up getting a letter from my draft board saying, would you like to join us in Vietnam and see a lot of interesting places, but probably on your knees and elbows carrying an M1, or have you considered that you were accepted to graduate school last year but held it off? And I said, as much as I like living in Paris and writing fiction and doing very interesting things, I'm suddenly excited by graduate school. And so I ended up at Stanford, which felt to me like a very, very nice prison compared to the life I had. And that the psychology department seemed devoid of anything that now filled my consciousness, which is, what on earth was I experiencing? What was that about? Had anyone else ever done it in history? The feeling of true exploration is a remarkable one. We get it very rarely in our lives. Little children who move from toddler to walking and the whole view changes, it's about that level. So I went to a museum in Amsterdam and was looking at Impressionists, and I'd go around and say, that one knew, and that one didn't. And I knew I was right. Now, in retrospect, I would hesitate. But I think I started with this kind of propensity to arrogance, and psychedelics didn't lower it. So I hit graduate school, and psychology was really dull and uninteresting and constricting and boring. And I thought, if I did not have this other option of being drafted, I would leave. But being drafted was a kind of like a little hand waving in the background saying, we're ready if you are. And there was one person at Stanford named Willis Harmon. And Willis Harmon was teaching what was called a graduate special outside the system on the human potential. And in that class, you were to look at various areas of literature and science and philosophy and religion and look at what could we say about the human potential. And I went into his office and he said, oh, I'm sorry, my course is full, but maybe next quarter. And I looked at him and with a burst of intuition, I said, I've had psilocybin 3 times. And he got up, walked across his office, which looked exactly like the office of an associate professor of electrical engineering should look like. There wasn't anything in it that wasn't, you know, dull and full of mathematical symbols. Closed the door and said, let's talk. So we taught that course that quarter because he knew I was willing to talk about my psychedelic experiences and he wasn't about to blow his cover. And so I thought to myself, I have nothing to lose except that they'll throw me out of the university and I'll get killed. But other than that, I had nothing to lose. And so I very, very delicately worked my way through my graduate career, staying, in a sense, one step ahead of them catching me for being a far-out freak. And one of the ways I did it, for example, is I was the only graduate student in the psychology department that always showed up in a jacket and tie, because everyone else wore what you would wear in California. But I thought, these professors, since they have no idea what's going on inside my head, if I look straight, they'll assume I'm straight. And they did. And so I would do psychology by day, and at night I would be desperately giving myself an education, and reading the Tibetan Book of the Dead, and reading Jung, and reading Alan Watts, and making contact with the tiny bit, the few researchers really in those days that existed. So that's how I got into it, is through this professorial friend, and then at Stanford, really a research model, because in before the government decided that learning is inherently bad for you, there were what was called investigational drug licensed. And LSD was the most researched drug in the world. And I had from Sandoz, when I was still in my second year of graduate school, a huge book of the first 1,000 research studies using this material. So this was the most researched drug, not in the world, but in psychiatry. And it was very exciting all over the world. And I was part of this early research team with a group called the International Foundation for Advanced Study in Menlo Park. LSD is a powerful mind-opening drug that, depending entirely on set and setting, or what we might call expectation and the situation, will take you beyond your own personal limits in those directions. So if you take it in a situation of danger, you will be into a state of such terror as cannot be imagined. If you take it in a loving state, you will be in a kind of communication of bliss as you've never imagined. It is not at all a drug that's useful for being sexual, because the identification with the body really is secondary. So it doesn't, it is wonderful for communion in a safe enough space, but it is not a kind of an emotion, like ecstasy is much more a hanging out with people just emotionally drug. And it doesn't take you to many, many other places. LSD is actually, my best definition is, there's a character in literature called Baron Munchausen. And Baron Munchausen, among other things, at one point gets on his horse and rides off in all directions. For me, LSD is an all-direction experience, and it depends very much on the set and setting in which directions it'll go. My own training was to maximize its therapeutic value, but you maximize its therapeutic value by helping people transcend their personal identity and have a transcendental, spiritual, religious, mystic, whatever one calls it, experience, and have enough of a vocabulary about that world from prior experience so that when one returns, one carries with one some idea that this makes sense. The usual experience that someone in a good LSD session would say is, I was more real than I have ever been in my life, and that this world, while it is real, is not as real as the world I entered into. So is it a spiritual experience? Is the answer is sometimes, under the right conditions. But under the right conditions, it almost always is. Out of the people who were then using psychedelics, which included now many, many people, one of the revolutions that doesn't give psychedelics its full credit is called the computer revolution. And if you went to the first hackers conference, now these are the people who are really the very brightest people, both many of them starting companies or have started companies, but they're the people who just love to play with this stuff. And you say to them, how many of you were fundamentally influenced to go into this part of the computer world through your own personal psychedelic experience.